नमस्कार फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू द वीडियो विच इज डेडिकेटेड डिस्कशन ऑन यूलिप्रिस्टल एसीटेट विच इज वी ऑल नो इट इज अ सेलेक्टिव प्रोजेस्टेरॉन रिसेप्टर मॉड्यूलेटर विच केम टू बी एज अ वेरी प्रॉमिसिंग वंडर ड्रग विच वॉज यूज फॉर द ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ मेडिकल मैनेजमेंट ऑफ फाइब्रॉइड इजेंट इट इट वॉज येस ऑफकोर्स एंड एज सून as we used to feel very comfortable with the drug, the DCGI, it banned the drug's use. Why it banned, why it was so promising, we'll all discuss. Especially, although the drug is not in use now, but you should be aware about the history which was associated with this drug so that we can make ourselves aware about this. And being a gynecologist, being a master's in this subject, we are bound to know this. If you are a postgraduate, if you get the leiomyoma case, long case or even short case in your exam, then definitely the examiner will ask you something about this medical management, which was very promising and but now it is not of any use to us. So a brief discussion about what is leiomyoma. We all know it is a monoclonal proliferation of the smooth muscle cell of the uterine musculature. And what extra we do have in this leiomyoma, it is extracellular matrix, because in leiomyoma apoptosis is reduced. Okay, there is proliferation is more and also apoptosis is less, so it becomes leiomyoma. We all know what are the causative agent. We know that exact etiology is definitely not known by far. What we expect is some hormonal changes, and moreover it is nowadays said that there are some ischemic damage during menses that is occurring. That ischemic damage may lead to some epigenetic changes which causes this monoclonal proliferation along with extracellular matrix. So this is uterine fibroid. We have discussed in detail about what is the etiology, what are the presenting symptoms, what are the investigation we are going to do, differential diagnosis, how to differentiate it, and what is the treatment. So in treatment we saw that there is medical management, there is minimal invasive surgery and definitive surgery, which is hysterectomy. So for medical management, in earlier days hysterectomy was the only treatment available, but as because of the advances in the medical sciences, minimal invasive surgeries came into existence and also some medical management came into existence, which are now enabling women to retain their fibroid. And during that medical management, because it is a tumor which is most commonly present in the 40s, 50s, so woman then enters the menopause and now there is no need for any hysterectomy. So the medical management has enabled the woman to preserve their uterus and avoid any surgical complications. So uliprystal, it emerged as a brilliant medicine. It was considered a boon. But how it got removed, we'll discuss very shortly. Now, some basic things you should be aware about. If you are a postgraduate and if you want to give super specialty entrance exam, then also, and also if you are a MBBS student, then it was, when was this leiomyomata first discovered? It was first discovered, described in fact, in 1791 by Matthew Bailey at St. George Hospital in London. So this is a brief history that it was diagnosed, and it is a most common tumor of reproductive age group in women of uterus, most common tumor, and almost 20-30% of women, those who have leiomyoma, they need treatment. So we have already discussed that all leiomyomas, they do not require any treatment, and almost 20-30% of women, those who have fibroid, they require management. Earlier we had only option of hysterectomy, but advances have enabled us to preserve the uterus and even fertility. So progesterone is known to cause increase in the fibroid size, because the fibroid, they have both estrogen and progesterone receptors. Also the progesterone receptors of both A and B, they are present in fibroid. Okay, and what else? They are present in a number which is higher as compared to the normal myometrium. So both the progesterone receptors are present in the fibroid, and it is said, noted that progesterone stimulation causes increase in fibroid. So it gave us an idea that the drugs, chemicals which are having the different mechanism of action, antagonist or selective blockers, they can promise as a treatment option. Selective progesterone receptor modulator, so they have a direct effect in what this do. It decreases the proliferation, also it increases the apoptosis. How it increases the apoptosis? By down regulating the anti-apoptotic factors. It increases the apoptosis, it decreases the proliferation. By directly down regulating the anti-apoptotic factor, which is there because of some epigenetic changes we just discussed now. Also anti-fibrotic and factors are reduced, and growth factors are also reduced. So all of this causes what? It causes decrease in the size of fibroid or leiomyoma, you can say. So this is the, when it is decreased, it also leads to control of the symptoms of the woman. So this is how it acts. Also you should be aware about what are progesterone receptor modulator associated endometrial changes. So it is called as PAEC, progesterone receptor modulator associated endometrial changes. When a woman is taking progesterone receptor modulator, that is uliprystal, what happens? Her endometrium is getting some alternative changes. It is undergoing some changes. It is also proliferation, secretory activity, they both are altered. So those changes on histopathology, they are very specific. What are these? There is cystic dilatation of the glands. Also the glands, they are lined by inactive lining. So these are progesterone receptor modulator associated endometrial changes. It is necessary if you are subjecting a woman who is on progesterone receptor modulator therapy, if you are doing an endometrial biopsy, sending it to histopathologist, in your notes make sure to write down that the woman is taking progesterone receptor modulator, because otherwise the pathologist may get confused about the changes, because the changes can neither be assigned to proliferative stage of endometrium nor can be assigned to secretory stage. What are the changes? It is cystic dilatation of the endometrial glands, irregular architecture lined with inactive gland cells, and non-decidualized stroma. So these are the changes observed in glands as well as in stroma, and it cannot be classified either to proliferative or to secretory. Now what? If your woman is on uliprystal acetate, what is going to happen? There is some endometrial hypertrophy. In various studies that has been conducted over this drug, it has been found that these changes that are occurring in her endometrium, they are reversible by 3 months. Reversible by 3 months after stopping the therapy. What more? If a woman is having persistent endometrial proliferation, endometrial hypertrophy, and especially this persistent endometrial hypertrophy persists 3 months beyond the stoppage of this treatment, subject her to endometrial biopsy. And what is that? criteria more than 16 millimeter of endometrial thickness. If it is present even beyond 3 months of the stopping of this therapy, subject her to endometrial biopsy to rule out other causes of endometrial hypertrophy, especially endometrial carcinoma. What next? This we have seen about endometrium. This progesterone receptor modulator, it acts on the fibroid cell. It also acts on the endometrium. It also acts on the hypothalamic axis, uterine axis. So what is happening? This progesterone is acting as anti-progesterone at the fibroid, but FSH levels are not reduced much. FSH levels are not reduced much, and hence the estradiol level, E2 level, they are also not suppressed. So what advantage we do have over this GnRH analog? They suppress everything, GnRH analog, and women experiences hot flushes and postmenopausal estrogen deficiency symptoms. But with this ulipristal acetate, we have got a beneficial effect on the reduction of the volume of the fibroid, but also the estradiol levels are not much altered. They are present in around mid follicular levels. When they were checked, research centers where women were being studied while using ulipristal, it was found that they are maintained at mid follicular levels, this estradiol. So hot flushes, they are not very common, and also the bones, they are preserved, and we don't have that harmful effect of GnRH analog along with this. So this is the advantage of this drug over GnRH analog as the medical management option. So this is important to know why it is better than GnRH analog. Throughout the cycle, estrogen is present throughout the treatment, so it is getting the endometrium is getting unopposed estrogen stimulation. That's why the treatment has to be only for 12 weeks at one time, then break off to menstrual cycle. Break off two menstrual cycle, and if you want to initiate again the treatment after a break of two menstrual cycle, you can again start the 12 week therapy again. You have to be very much informative to the woman who is taking this treatment. Now no woman is taking this treatment in India, but you should be aware that why it is important to have breaks or intermittent therapy, why it cannot be given continued, because of this estrogen that is having stimulation over the endometrium. So we have to counter this effect also. So we give intermittent therapy 12 weeks, then a break of two menstrual cycle, then 12 week again, then a break of two menstrual cycle, and then we can go for repeated cycles. So this is the importance, why it is break is important. So these are basics. In case of mifepristone, which is available in the market as anti-progesterone, what we do, we give a continuous cycle of 6 months. We give it continuous 6 months. So what else? Pearl studies is associated with this. Pearl first, Pearl second, Pearl third, and Pearl fourth. So this was associated, these were the trials associated with ulipristal. Pearl first was the first, it was done in Europe. Women who were posted, who were waiting for surgery, they were given this 12 weeks course of ulipristal. And it was found, it was very promising that menorrhagia is controlled, and also it is also controlled. Size is also reduced. Then Pearl 2, it what it did, it randomized trial and it monitor, it compared the efficacy of this uricrystal acetate with GnRH analog. They were short term, only one cycle was studied of this uricrystal, but while third and pearl fourth, they studied about the repeated cycles. So these are the important things you should be aware. It can also come as an MCQ. Pearl is for drug withdrug uricrystal, and pearl first and second were short term, and pearl third and fourth, they studied the repeated cycles of the drug. It is a must to separate the two cycles by two menstrual cycle break, and why it is so we have discussed. Now what next? If you are initiating this therapy, in India it is banned definitely, but in European countries the drug use is restricted. We will see to what level it is restricted, and you should be aware, when you want to initiate this uricrystal therapy, you have to first do LFT before initiation of the therapy. And if a woman is having two times the upper normal limit of ALT, SGOT or SGPT, ALT, AST, then you will not initiate the treatment. This LFT is to be repeated monthly on a woman who is taking this uricrystal acetate. This monthly checking of LFT is must in first two cycle. First cycle is 12 weeks, then two menstrual cycle break, then second cycle of 12 weeks again. So during this treatment, monthly testing of LFT is required. It is must. So this is must when you are doing this for initial two cycles. After the two cycles, you will do it every 3 monthly or earlier if required. If a woman comes with you fatigue, or she is having loss of appetite, or she is having yellowing of skin, so the symptoms that are associated with liver disease, if she comes to you, you will do it repeatedly. During the LFT assessment, when she is on uricrystal acetate, when will you stop the treatment? When? You will stop the treatment if her SGOT, SGPT levels are 3 times the upper normal limit. If it is 3 times, then you will stop the treatment, and then you, after stopping the therapy, you will be doing LFT again 2 weekly and then 4 weekly to see whether the changes are reverting back. This is the only reason few women after these trials, when the drug was available in open market for treatment, it was found that some few women, they developed liver failure which required even liver transplant. So it was not a small thing which can be ignored. The European Medicine Association, they withheld the they restricted the use, and in India by viewing these reports in the DCGI, it banned the drug and said that it has not to be manufactured in our country. So what are the contraindications? As the metabolism is present in liver, so it has not to be used. The drug is to be modified, or it has not to be used with those women who are taking the enzyme, either suppressor or inducers. Like those women who are on medicines like erythromycin or itraconazole or ketoconazole, you will not be giving them. Also, it is contraindicated in women who are having asthma and who are on glucocorticoid for control of that asthma. And lactating women are also not supposed to take this medicine. It is contraindicated. Now coming to pregnancy, in the Pearl trials, we all know that the woman who is willing to preserve her uterus for any reason, maybe फॉर फर्टिलिटी और मे बी फॉर अदर बेनिफिट्स. तो इन दोज वुमेन इट वॉज रिपोर्टेड इन पर्ल्ड आफ्टर पर्ल ट्रायल डेट आफ्टर स्टॉपिंग द ट्रीटमेंट 18 वुमेन रिपोर्टेड प्रेगनेंसी आउट ऑफ विच 12 गेव बर्थ टू 13 न्यूनेट्स एंड 12 प्रेगनेंसीज रिजल्टेड इन बर्थ एंड 6 प्रेगनेंसीज दे गॉट मिसकैरेजेस. आउट ऑफ दीज 13 न्यूनेट्स हुआ बॉर्न टू वुमेन नो टेराटोजेनिक इफेक्ट इज ऑब्जर्व्ड. एंड इन एनिमल स्टडीज ऑल्सो टेराटोजेनिसिटी इज नॉट ऑब्जर्व्ड बट इट इज नॉट टू बी गिवन फॉर वाइल वुमेन इज लैक्टेटिंग बिकॉज इट इज सिक्रेटेड इन द ब्रेस्ट मिल्क. सो ब्रेस्ट फीडिंग इज अ कॉन्ट्राइंडिकेशन टू द यूज ऑफ दिस ड्रग. इट वॉज रियली वेरी प्रॉमिसिंग ड्रग. मैनी वुमेन because of and it as it was it can be used repeated cycles. It was found that women were happy in taking this medicine by with breaks and they could reach menopause and the whole thing is now not required. So they could avoid the surgery. Almost around 80% women were happy with the and they were benefited with the medical management. So one study was also conducted at AIIMS Patna. Which was published in 2021 September. But as the drug was banned, all the women they studied the two cycles with the break of two menstrual cycle period in between the two cycle. It was also found very promising and in that study there was no any liver injury reported with the use of this medicine. So now what this European Medicines Agency, what they how they restricted the use. They restricted the use because of these liver failure cases who required even liver transplant. The use of this drug was limited to two conditions only. Both the two conditions should be fulfilled. Woman is premenopausal and also she cannot undergo either surgical or minimal invasive surgery. If she is having fibroid, if such a woman who is premenopausal and because of her other medical condition she cannot undergo either surgical treatment or minimal invasive surgery treatment, and if she is having fibroid and if she is having menorrhagia because of that fibroid, then she can only in these condition the woman can be given uliprystal acetate. These two conditions have to be fulfilled simultaneously. It's not like this ki either she is premenopausal or she is not surgically fit. She has to be premenopausal and she is also not surgically, she is not fit for surgical treatment. For those women who are waiting for the surgical treatment, they are not to be given uliprystal acetate in the meantime till surgery is awaited. This is very important. The use is restricted in Europe, but in India it is totally banned. If a woman comes to you, if a woman is on uliprystal and she comes to you with yellowing of skin or lethargy or decreased appetite, you will do immediately her LFT, and if you find that LFT, her SGOT, SGPT levels are more than 3 times of the upper normal limit, you have to stop the drug immediately. What else? This uliprystal acetate is also available in 30 milligram preparation as emergency contraceptive, which is to be used in 5 days of unprotected intercourse. It is found that the single dose which is used as emergency contraception is up till now it has not been found to cause any liver injury. So this indication is maintained. This use of this medicine is maintained, but the use of 5 or 10 milligram for fibroid management, medical management is restricted. So this is very important. You should be aware about this medicine. It has covered almost all the thing, indication, contraindication, what precaution, when endometrial biopsy is to be performed, what are the different endometrial changes associated with it, and why it got banned and removed from the market. All things are covered. If you have any questions or queries relating to this subject, do ask me, I'll reply. And if you like the video, please like and subscribe to the channel and share among your friends. Thank you.